There's just too much stuff. There's just like too many things to buy. There's too many options. Like honestly, I feel like in the 1950s, there was like one couch and everyone had the same couch. I think that is true. And now there's so many options and it makes shopping for your home feel like this impossible code you have to crack. And I'm just very opposed to the idea that decorating your home is ever stressful. My mission is to make it not stressful for you. So today, I don't wanna be stressed. I have my wine, I'm in bed. We're gonna hang out. We're also really gonna talk about like the decision tree process for choosing furniture. I've put together a cohesive guide for how to choose things like a rug. I've never seen anyone else do this, so I did it for you. How to test out furniture pieces in your home, how to evaluate them. And I'm gonna use some examples of a recent room makeover I'm working on, if you've kept up with that, the subscriber Dark Academia room makeover. I'm gonna have some updates in here. If you haven't watched that video, go watch that video, great video. We're just having a good time. We're also gonna play a game of how long it takes me to knock over this glass of red wine onto my bed. It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. Let's do this. I want to start by talking about how to choose a rug. It feels really impossible to find like rules. Just how do you choose a rug? People ask that question all the time, and I've never seen a cohesive guide for doing that, so I tried to put one together for you. Remember, there's not like one correct rug for your space. There's a lot of different options. Step number one is that you have to be clear on your vision board, your North Star, like what are we moving towards? It can be an inspo board, but it needs to be an inspo board that's been pretty focused down, filtered down to something that like every time you look at your collection of images, you're like, yep, okay, that's where we're headed. I like to make my vision board by doing a little like design Tinder design swiping. I made a whole video on that. Great video.
Wow, so many great videos, Caroline.
That's why you should subscribe, okay? Let's specifically walk through the steps of how to choose a rug. Step number one, you need to have your vision board solidified in order to do the next couple steps, because that will inform everything. So once we have the vision board ready, we're looking at a space in your home that probably already has a bunch of stuff in it, and looking at what's already in the room, you want to ask yourself, what are we looking to add here? Are we looking to add more contrast or more cohesion? And it's probably gonna be one or the other. This is the way I think about it. Honestly, usually I look at color. Looking in the space, like if everything is like matchy-matchy in color, personally, I would like to add a little more contrast with something like the rug. That's the opportunity to add in like either an interesting pattern or an accent color or something to make it a little more interesting. Otherwise, it's gonna fall flat if it's all matchy-matchy. On the other end of things, if you look around the space, the existing stuff is all like a little contrasting already, and what we need is to connect it all together. The rug can be a great way to make the different colors, the different items relate to each other. So first we need to just decipher, are we looking to add more cohesion or are we looking to add more contrast? So when you're looking at the space and trying to decide like how many colors are already in here, we're looking at like the major colors that show up in this room, not every tiny little accessory. But if there's already three or more colors, then I would say we want to work on cohesion. We want to work on just relating them. We don't really want to add in a ton more. If there's less than three colors, three major colors present, then we can probably afford to add more color or interest or pattern or something with the rug. We can add a new thought, and that's what's going to make it feel designed and really complete. I say three or more, we're good on colors, let's add cohesion. Less than three, let's add a little more interest, let's add that contrast. I also do not count neutral as a color. So that's step number one, add contrast or add cohesion. Examples, okay, looking at this dining room, what colors we got? We've got, you know, dark wood, pretty neutral color in the chairs. There's wallpaper, but it's also very, very neutral. It's not very imposing. I would say we can afford to add some color, some pattern, some interest in the rug. Boom. Looking around this living room, we've got like a pretty bold color on the walls. Sofa's kind of a color. It's not like that different from the walls. It's still like dark, moody. There's a little more going on, but the rest is kind of neutral in a way. We can afford to inject some color and fun in with the rug. Great. Sweet, looking at this little bedroom, we've got like a pretty solidified color palette. There's like a pale pink on the walls. We've got some color both on the bedspread, a neutral on the side table. I would probably opt to keeping the rug neutral, just letting the existing color palette stay as is, not adding a ton more on top of it. Great. And yes, there are exceptions if you want to have just like a tone on tone, super neutral room. And there are options if you want to have a super maximalist color palette room, options for that later. Basically, that all comes down to what's your vision board. If you're clear on your vision board, then you don't ever have to like worry about which one you're having to do. Okay, some other characteristics you might want to balance using your rug. Pattern. I mentioned that a little bit, like there's a ton of pattern going on in that headboard. Do we want to add a ton more pattern? You definitely can, but it depends. Again, does your vision board reflect spaces that just go like super hard on pattern? Then the rules for pattern, in my opinion, these are pretty standard rules, is you want to vary the scale of your pattern. So you've got like a medium size pattern. Then make sure wherever else you put a pattern, there's like a small scale and a large scale. Or mix up like organic shape, florals with a checkered and a stripe. Like mix up what those patterns look like so that it's not all the same size flowers, not all the same size print. And that's where you're gonna get balance with pattern. But if your revision board doesn't reflect liking a million patterns, then I would say maybe you don't wanna add any more now. The other things you wanna consider are balancing brightness and boldness. If you're looking at your space and it's already like pretty moody, pretty dark, pretty deep, the rug then can be an opportunity to add something bright and get that contrast. Okay, so we got like a pretty dark, moody, intense room. I want to inject a little bit of like light and brightness with the rug. Great contrast. That's the contrast we want. If here we've got a super neutral room, like everything in the room is basically gray, camel, or white. So let's go bold with the rug and let that kind of like fuel design energy into the room from the ground up, which is fun. And when you're thinking about these things, brightness, dark, pattern, color, you don't have to work through every single one of these characteristics in your space and balance all of them. So the goal is not to like check off every single one of these in balance, but you can find one or two that you feel like you want to use the rug to balance out and bring that contrast. You just have to spend some time like staring at your room, getting in touch with yourself. So just become a little detective in your own space. Okay, now I'm gonna hit you with a couple of cheat codes. This is good stuff. Number one cheat code is a tip from my editor, Paige, who told me that rugs, what is it? Rugs USA, Rugs Direct, Rugs. Rugs Direct.
Hey team, so quick PSA from Paige, the editor here. Caroline is trying to tell you about a site called Revival Rugs. She's not gonna figure that out though. She's gonna struggle for a little bit. She's eventually gonna come to Rugs Direct. The rug selection at Rugs Direct is abysmal, frankly. And I just want you to know that you have better options, okay? Check out Revival Rugs, pictured here. Great selection of rugs, fantastic. Let's not be too harsh on Caroline though. Just know that you can use Revival Rugs, okay? You don't have to struggle like this, so go forth.
Rugs Direct has a rug visualization tool that you can use. You literally just upload an image of your space and you can layer all the rugs into it. It does all the, you know, photoshopping for you. It's so, so good. I've been doing it like crazy recently. I'm gonna put that link in here. Not sponsored. They don't even care that I'm alive. They don't even care if I live or die. Use the rug visualizer, even honestly, if you don't end up getting that exact rug, but just to experiment with like, okay, what color makes this blue room really fun? What color makes these two pieces of furniture make sense together? It's so much more helpful to have the visual because it's a visual medium. It's not supposed to be thinking and whatever. It's supposed to be looking at stuff. So use this rug visualizer. Just very, very helpful. Thank you, Paige, for a great tip. Okay, let's just get into this visualizer and I'm gonna show you my hot, hot tip. So let's upload, this is just a generic room I found online, no rug in here. What do I see? Let's talk through the steps. I see blue, I see white. We got some throw pillows, that's basically it. So I would consider this a room with like one color, and I'd say we can definitely afford to add some color in, add some fun in. The cheat code I want you to know is that if you're stumped, and in your living room or your bedroom or something, you have your bed or you have your sofa and you have throw pillows already, and you need a rug, just match your rug to your throw pillows. And let me show you. I want a dark blue, baby. Give me a pretty dark blue. Actually, I don't like that. This is why we try. I'm not loving these rugs, I'll be honest with you. Dark blue rug. Great. It matches, it works, it's cohesive. We match it to that accent pillow. Is this the world's most interesting room? To me, no. I would like it to have a little more contrast, but it totally works. Okay, let's see if instead, let's see how like a pink. Great. It takes us in a little bit more of like a glam girly direction, especially pairing that pink with the gold and marble coffee tables, but totally works. What this makes me learn is like, I don't like going light on the floor because the walls are already light. It's like a light walls and ceiling, medium tone couch, and then light floor. I don't like this light sandwich that much. I think I would rather go for something medium tone or darker. So that's what this experimentation helps me learn, my preference. Let's see if we can find another pink that would work. This works. We got some texture in there. We pulled some of those warm tones. It works. Anyway, so if you're at a loss, I just suggest trying to match a rug to your throw pillows. Like, it's at least gonna be cohesive. But I think for me personally, in my taste, I would like to have a little more pattern, a little more friction in this room. But something I do like to do is go to this color palette generator, take the color of this couch, and see what it throws at us. Do I like any of these? Ooh, I kind of like this bolder. Is it a fuchsia? Let's see. I like this a bit. Adding like a warmer tone into the room feels so much more interesting to me. Yeah, than just having another blue one. That's so much more interesting to me. I love how that feels. That feels like really cozy, warm, inviting. What I'm learning looking and clicking through different rugs is that I personally like the contrast of some good pattern. So maybe like a Persian rug, a little more pattern. I like that contrast with the sofa. It just feels more interesting. And I'm liking a warmer tone. Those of you who are watching and say, but I like a neutral room. I don't want a balanced color. I don't want to add a bunch more pattern. I like neutral. Great. Excellent. That is your right. That is your right to like a neutral room. And there's a lot of great ways to do that. So if I was aiming for a neutral room, you still want to add in interest and variation and contrast, but you can just do that through texture, through different tones of the same neutral, tone on tone, through your artwork, of course, and through having like interesting profiles to neutrally colored furniture. Okay, so I love this living room image where like barely a color to be seen, right? But they've got a lot of different textured furniture pieces, texture on the ceiling, texture on the wall with those curtains hanging. The curtains are just white, but they're adding texture, adding dimension and variation. And then these chairs, I feel like, are the showstopper. They're just like a really interesting profile, and they've got a very neutral rug that doesn't add a ton in terms of color, but they've got the interest coming in so many other ways. So if you see a neutral room and you're like, hey, that one works though, like, this is, shut up, Caroline. True, I agree, and this is why I think it works. Let's just look through, I just wanna play around with this rug visualizer because it's fun, and talk through a couple different spaces and like how I would think about them. We got a little bedroom going on. So looking at the space, I would be like, the colors I see, blue, white, that's pretty much freaking it. So I really count that as one color because white's a neutral. I also see it's a lot of solid colors, not a lot of pattern, not a lot of texture. I would love to add some interest. There's like a lot of people who love just white and blue. If you're the white and blue gal, then I'd be like, okay, we probably just want to go a different tone of blue, something that can relate the dark blue dressers, that's like built-in dresser thing, to the bright white walls. What's the transition between them? Maybe a medium tone blue. So let's go look for that. Where's a nice medium tone blue? Yeah, look at that. Very neutral. We've stayed in the like white and blue. If you're someone who likes to have more color in your space, I am, then I probably wouldn't just add another blue. I would think of like, what are the tones we have going on? They're pretty cool toned. So I think what would be fun contrast would be something warm. So like reds, oranges, even like certain orange tone, certain brown tone. Let's just click around and see. Okay, not bad. I feel like this is the like Studio McGee version of the room. Boring, I don't like that. Let's see what else we got. Get some wine while we're at it. All these rugs look the same. That's annoying. I don't like that. I'll tell you what, I don't like that. So hard to find a good rug. I kind of like this. This is to me, basically a neutral, this rug. There's some color in it, but most importantly, there's some texture and some variation. I think it makes the room a lot more interesting. Ooh, plaid. I love plaid. I like the amount of pattern it adds and the warmth, the color contrast. Ooh, that's a cool one. Oh, I think that's really pretty. I like that that has both the blue and a bit of the reds and stuff. The bed is either a red-toned wood or it's an actual red bed, I can't tell. But I like that this rug kind of like relates the bed and the blue of the dresser to each other. And it's like, yeah, these were chosen intentionally. It's not just two other random things. I don't know if looking at that rug, I would have been able to pick out that it works in this room, but that's why the visualizer is super helpful. By the way, I feel your guys' eyes on me. I feel your eyes looking at this hot, sexy, cool bed, and that's because you're smart. It is a hot, sexy, cool bed. Speaking of how to buy things for your home, you gotta know what to invest in. And I have realized that my bed is not just a place for sleeping, and so I want my bed not just to be looking nice, but to be feeling welcoming and feeling exciting, whether I need to sit and read or watch a show or do a little work or some online shopping. I do it all here. And because you're smart and you like hot, sexy, cool things like I do, I want to go with a bedding set that is tested and awarded by GQ, Good Housekeeping, Wirecutter. So we're talking Brooklinen. You know, some people say Brooklinen sheets feel like luxury hotel sheets. I feel like that doesn't do it justice. There's like depth to these. There's a feeling to them. These sheets feel like forgiveness to me. These sheets feel like when you walk in a room and you smell a smell that takes you back to a childhood memory you didn't even know you had. That's what these sheets feel like, okay? Personally, I love their linen sheet set, washed linen. I'm a wild man and I sleep both with the window open in the winter, but I also sleep with a heating pad. I just like how it feels, and linen is the way to go. Whether you're a hot sleeper, a cold sleeper, or you sleep with the window open and heating pad, it's the only thing that's gonna keep you both like cozy and cool. I also really love their lamb's wool throw blankets, and I also just got a set of sheets for this upcoming room makeover for my brother. I'm gonna show you what I got him. I'm so excited. And you know me, you know I love to mix and match patterns and stuff. That's what's great about Brooklinen. Their online site is so easy to use and you can mix and match textures, colors, patterns. It's textured, it has a memory, and there's colors to it, but it's still neutral. There's a spirit to it, but it's understated. It's reserved, but it's mystery. Who is she? Where does she come from? How'd she learn to dance like that? You know, that's the feeling of these sheets. Lucky for you, you can bundle and save. I like to do the linen hardcore sheet bundle. If you too like things that are smart, sexy, cool, memory, forgiveness, love, forever, texture, depth, warmth, then click the link in the video to get 15% off your first Brooklinen order. And remember, you can bundle your order to save even more. You're not gonna regret it. And when you touch them, you'll understand what I mean when I say these feel like forgiveness. Okay, babies, let's talk furniture. I will strongly recommend learning to do very simple 2D floor plans. I'm not talking about like crazy three-dimensional architectural CAD drawings, but just like super simple floor plans. I do that for basically all of the rooms I design. Again, not sponsored, but I just use SketchUp, which is like a CAD drawing software, but they have a free version. And it's really worth learning to learn how to do a floor plan. It's really not complicated. It makes it so much easier for getting the right rug size, for knowing if you'll have enough room to walk around that table, if you have room for two accent chairs, or if you just need one and a smaller stool. Like, it's just the best thing ever. I think a lot of people are intimidated by trying to figure out how to like figure out the floor plan software, but it's really not complicated. Truly, if I can figure it out, you can. There's a great, great tutorial that takes you step by step through just building a floor plan, and it's free. I haven't learned to do anything else on it, and I never will. If you don't want to do the floor plan route, tape it out. Just get a roll of like blue painter's tape. This is great for before you buy a rug, tape out the dimensions of the rug on the floor. See, like, does this get all basically the front feet of my furniture on the rug? Making your purchases, you can be so much more confident about the purchases you're gonna make. And now I kind of want to go through like the decision tree of thinking about the characteristics that you might want to balance when shopping for furniture. First of all, looking at your space, most likely you only want one statement piece, at the very most, like one showstopper, the hero of the room, the focal point. And that could be this crazy custom sofa that you had upholstered. It could be this really wacky, bold piece of furniture. In the room, the Dark Academia subscriber room makeover I'm working on, the focal piece is actually gonna be the fireplace. We're retiling the fireplace. It's the center of the room, yes. And it's the thing you first see when you walk in, and we're gonna do like a bold color. So there, the focal piece is actually the fireplace. When you have too many competing pieces that are all wacky, all so interesting, it's like interesting and cool, but it's gonna be really hard for the eye to know where to go, and it's just gonna feel a little overwhelming. So the balance needs to start with, like, I would bring it down to one main statement piece if you're gonna have that. After that, the biggest tip I can give you when considering all the furniture pieces in your space is balancing legginess. So a leggy chair has a lot of leg to it. Did I need to explain that? Probably not. But yeah, balancing legginess. Things that are higher up on long legs, things that have spindly legs, things that have like kind of chunkier legs, or maybe sit directly on the floor. You want a balance of legginess. One of the most common issues I see in rooms that subscribers submit to me is that there's just like leggy furniture everywhere, and it looks messy in the end. It ends up looking very messy, I think, to the eye, and very busy, and it doesn't give a lot of grace for like wanting to hide some of your mess. You know, if everything is leggy and there's lines everywhere, then you don't have a lot of margin for like clutter to build up at all. So the more legginess there is, the more the room's already gonna feel busy and kind of chaotic. Another way of thinking this is like visual weight, the visual heaviness of furniture. Whether it's heavy or not, does it look visually heavy? Because you could have the coffee table we put in the subscriber room makeover. It has visual lightness because it's very, very leggy. So that legginess next to a very grounded sofa ends up having good balance. One of the other characteristics I think people overlook the most is basically bringing in height variation. Stand in your room, look at like the silhouettes of all the furniture. Does everything come up just exactly to the same height? It's gonna fall really flat. It's probably leaving you feeling like the top half of the room isn't decorated. It's probably just like feeling everything's like down on one level. The safest bet is to just like think about height variation. Other characteristics you want to probably balance are how many furniture pieces are upholstered versus not upholstered. And if you have a bunch of upholstered furniture, then you want to think about varying the fabrics, varying the pattern scale like we talked about. If it's a lot of non-upholstered furniture, okay, but then you really want to focus on varying the texture, like wood, metal, glass, but making sure there's texture variation. Otherwise, it ends up feeling, again, flat and like you're just very one note. Okay, speaking of that coffee table that we put in the subscriber Dark Academia room, one tip that my mom gave me is that every room needs something black. Every room needs something black. And like, okay, it's not like a hard and fast rule, for real, but it's kind of fun to say that it's a rule. I think that it's a nice thing to throw in. If you're kind of feeling stumped with your space and it's falling flat, look around and be like, is there one good black thing in here? And I think it just adds like the correct amount of edge, the correct amount of interest. Black in a way goes with everything because it's not like adding a new color, but it's still a kind of powerful and bold neutral to add. Maybe it would be really fun to have even just one bold black vase on top of your white countertop. That contrast is gonna be so fun. Maybe it's the black coffee table in the middle of your otherwise like muted room. But having some black accent, I think, is like instantly stylish. Okay, so I'm gonna talk through some examples. Again, using the subscriber Dark Academia living room as an example, which I really would recommend subscribing so you can keep up with the makeover. So we had this existing sofa. It was the subscriber Emma's sofa. She already had it. Really nice quality sofa. We ended up reupholstering it just to make it a little more fresh, modern, like match the colors to the space. We'd painted the space all kind of like burgundy. Very, very fun. It's very dramatic, I will say. And because we had that very like warm, grounded, upholstered sofa, I knew that with our accent chairs, we wanted at least one that was a little bit visually lighter. These are some of the chairs I considered. Either had like a really interesting profile, a little leggier, or had a wood frame and could be reupholstered, but they were still, there was like a delicateness to them because we've already got like this chunk of a sofa. And then I ended up buying a really chunky kind of English roll arm armchair off of Facebook Marketplace for like a few hundred dollars. We're gonna reupholster that bad boy. And that's kind of the middle ground. We've got super chunky grounded sofa. We've got very leggy accent chair. And then for this other accent chair, it is chunky and it's pretty low to the ground. It's not very leggy, but it's got a little baby legs, little stumps, little pig's feet. They got feet, right? So it kind of hits that middle ground of being grounded or really leggy. Then when we were thinking about the accent tables, side tables, the little end tables, and the coffee table, we went super leggy with the coffee table. It looks kind of light and streamlined, simple lines. And with the side tables, again, we wanna hit that middle ground. You know, if I put like a really leggy, tall, eatsy little side table on the end, it would feel like the sofa wasn't being properly anchored. So with the side tables, we wanted to hit that like middle ground of something where that like a breeze can pass through. Not that we have breezes passing through, but that's kind of the feeling that we wanted next to this super grounded, super chunko sofa. I will say with the side tables, like it took a little bit of experimenting. And this is what you have to do. You gotta test things out in the space. Don't be afraid to test things out. I know it can be a pain to return things, but sometimes it's what you have to do. Like I made so many kind of trial purchases for this space, mostly from Facebook Marketplace or things I thrifted, that I tried it in the space and they just didn't work out. I have like a whole furniture graveyard of things that like they look beautiful, it's a cool concept, but you have to try it out in the space, and it's until you get it in the space that you won't realize why something's a little off. For example, I had this like little mini library ladder that I thought would be so cool to put in this library den. I liked that it was visually lighter, the wood, it was pretty, it's kind of romantic, but the reality of taking it in the space and lining it up next to shelves, I didn't like the look. The way that like the height of the steps kind of were in a fight with the height of the bookshelves. And it was something that I don't know what way there was around that other than trying it out in the space. So test things in the space. I ended up reselling the library stairs. I think I just like made back the money I made. If you want to be a savage about it, you can try and probably make a profit. But don't be afraid to just try things, resell them if you have to. There's a good market for it. Okay, I think the PSA of this video, at least for furniture, is that I really encourage trying things out in the space. Play around with it. In summary, when considering furniture, let's choose one statement piece, one hero, one focal point. Think about balancing legginess in your furniture, balancing the visual weight or lightness, height variation. Let's get those heights varied, please. Varying either upholster amount of upholstered and unupholstered furniture, and among your upholstered furniture, varying the scale of pattern, among your non-upholstered furniture, varying the materials, the texture. And throw something in that's black. Throw in a black accent piece, that's what I'd say. That's all I got for you today. I'm a little tired. I've gotten through a glass and a half of wine and none of it spilled. So I think I get a star. If you made it this far, it's a great time to subscribe. I do lots of interior design videos. You also want to keep up with the Dark Academia themed subscriber room makeover I'm doing. I'm falling asleep. I'm sorry. I've filmed too much and I've made you look at me for too long. I'm gonna put links to fun stuff, products, rugs, cute things in the description of this video. I'm gonna put all my Amazon favorites, shopping links, cute things. You know where to find it. If you know somebody who is having trouble shopping for their home, furnishing their home, send them this video I made for them. And until then, be well. I'll see you soon.